All right. Well, we just want to thank you for joining us online. We have come together as a body of Christ to honor, to remember what Jesus has done for us. And so just to remember and honor him on this day. So I just invite you to join us as we enter into a time of worship. Wherever you're at, let's just take some time to focus on him and look to him today. So.
Here I am to worship, here I am to Of Jesus that brings us together today. Would you join me as we pray together? Thank you, God. Thank you for the cross. Everything that's represented in the cross, Lord. Thank you for forgiveness, for power that's released. Thank you for the assurance of eternal life. Jesus, we pray that today, as we sort of gather in this virtual way, that your Holy Spirit would be working and active in our minds and in our hearts as this service continues. Speak to us. We make ourselves available to you right now, Lord. And we ask you, God, to come and have your way. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Hey. Great to have you here. Greetings and welcome. I'm Pastor Hollis Graves. I'm the lead pastor here at Journey. And we want to say thanks for joining us for this Good Friday virtual service. We are pleased and honored to be partnering with one of another church in Cloquet, with Good Hope Church. And thankful to have Pastor Mike Stevens with us. He'll be joining us in a few moments in the Word, and also some members of their worship team from their church. And isn't it awesome when God's people can connect together and cooperate together? I get the privilege of sharing the first part of the message. We're actually going to be focusing today on the words of Jesus on the cross. Now, everything Jesus said was significant, right? Whether he said it from a hillside or from a boat, or from a temple, or from someone's home. The words of Jesus are meaningful, but perhaps they're even more meaningful and more impactful when we hear the words of Jesus spoken from the cross. I get the privilege of talking about the first phrase that we're going to focus on today, and that is, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing." It probably helps first to talk about a basic definition for forgiveness. Forgiveness is to excuse or to pardon an offense. It's to cancel a debt. There was a Sunday school teacher that had just concluded her lesson, and she wanted to make sure that the kids got the point. And so she asked them a question. She said, "Students, what does a person need to do in order to obtain forgiveness of sin?" There was quietness for a while, and then finally one little boy in the back raised his hand and said, "Sin?" Yeah. Most of us are pretty good at that. Okay, all of us are pretty good at that. Now, as we look at the words of Jesus, "Father, forgive them," let's put them into context. They were the first words recorded of what Jesus said on the cross. Perhaps they were the first words that Jesus said while he was on the cross. And if you turn to Luke chapter 23, starting in verse 32, we'll see this account. And Luke records it like this. He says, "Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him along with the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. Jesus said, 'Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing.' And they divided his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, 'He saved others, let him save himself, if he is Christ of God, the chosen one.' The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, 'If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself.' There was a written notice above him which read, 'This is the king of the Jews.'" Father, forgive them. Now, these words were likely spoken while Jesus was being mocked, perhaps even while the nails were being placed and pounded into his hands and into his feet. When we look at the Greek verb tense, we actually see that this indicates that Jesus prayed this prayer of intercession more than one time. You see, the verb is in the imperfect, active, indicative form, and that denotes like a repeated action, like, "Father, forgive them. Father, forgive them. Father, forgive them." Of course, the soldiers that were crucifying him would have heard him. I would think that these words would be surprising to them. They were probably used to hearing a lot of other kinds of things coming from the criminals that were being crucified. People that were begging for mercy, that were recanting, probably cursing. But forgive? This would be astounding. This would be surprising. This would be stunning and not soon forgotten. So let's break it down. The first word was "Father." This is a term that focuses on relationship. It's a term of endearment. This is really remarkable because it still senses a connection. It's not resentful. It's not doubtful thoughts towards his father. Jesus still believed that God was his loving father. And as a loving father, he would do the best for him. All that happened during that last few brutal hours of Jesus' life had in no way shaken his faith. This should provide a lesson for us. Because when life is hard and unfair, and when disaster and heartache strike, when we suffer from sickness or the loss of a job, or the loss of income, or stress and uncertainty, we're often tempted or even inclined to question God's love and care for us, the goodness of God. In times like these, we might even say to ourselves, if not out loud, does God still love me? You see, Jesus' first word on the cross should remind us that we can always believe in God's goodness. We can always trust in his loving purposes. He's our Father. The next words, forgive them, are just as, if not more, amazing. First and foremost, on Jesus' mind, in the midst of his agony and suffering, is forgiveness towards those that were perpetrating those things upon him. Expressing mercy, pardoning an offense, canceling a debt, offering undeserved favor. If there ever was an exception to forgiveness, this cross experience of Jesus would be it. He was wrongly accused. He was undeserving. He was sinless and pure and loving and compassionate. Jesus was punctuating what he had taught all along during his ministry life on earth. In Luke chapter 6, starting in verse 27, this is from a teaching of Jesus. He says this, "But I tell you who hear me, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who mistreat you." This cry of Jesus from the cross highlights the challenge to us to forgive others. Those who have mistreated us. Those who've offended us. And as I say that, I wonder if a particular name or a particular person comes to your mind. Maybe somebody that you haven't forgiven that you know you need to forgive. This could be the practical application for you as it relates to these words from Jesus on the cross. Let me just drill down into that just for a couple more minutes. As we ponder these words of Jesus on the cross, we hear echoes of other teachings from Jesus. As we consider extending forgiveness to others, we recognize that sometimes it isn't easy, but it's always necessary. For a disciple of Jesus Christ, forgiving others is not an option. We receive forgiveness in the same manner that we extend forgiveness to other people. In Matthew chapter 6, starting in verse 14, this is from Jesus. He says, "For if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sins, then your Father will not forgive you your sins." Earlier in the chapter, in the Lord's Prayer, just a couple verses before, Jesus, when he's teaching his disciples how to pray, says these words, "Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us." Paul said it this way in Colossians 3:13. He said, "Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you." Listen, this is not an emotion. This is a decision. We need to get past our feelings and get to decision and determination. Since God requires you to forgive, then it's something you can do. Andy Stanley said it this way. He said, "In the shadow of my hurt, forgiveness feels like a decision to reward my enemy. But in the shadow of the cross, forgiveness is merely a gift from one undeserving soul to another." So if you have someone you need to forgive, let me just invite you on this Good Friday. Pray to God for help. Receive his help. Embrace his help. Unhook that unforgiveness from your heart. Let it go. As you hear the words of Jesus from the cross today, "Father, forgive them," you can trust in the love of your heavenly Father, even in the midst of trial and challenge. You can reach out and receive forgiveness for yourself. We need forgiveness just as much as the Roman soldiers that nailed him to the cross needed forgiveness. And then you need to look to God for help in extending his grace and forgiveness to others. I think we can respond to this word by looking to the cross again. Let's sing together that wonderful old hymn, The Old Rugged Cross, and then Pastor Mike Stevens will join us for continuing the message.
Thank you. Cross, one of my favorite worship songs, one of my favorite hymns of all time. Tremendous, tremendous song, and so fitting for a Good Friday service. I'm Pastor Mike from Good Hope Church, and it's my pleasure to be here honoring and remembering what Jesus has done here at Journey Christian Church, our sister church, working together to honor the Lord. So again, my pleasure to be here. Thank you, Pastor Hollis and Journey, for inviting me. I'm going to reference the last words of Christ, my God, why have you forsaken me? I remember the first time going through the scriptures and noticing Jesus saying, my God, why have you forsaken me? And I thought, did he lose his faith? Was he heartbroken and felt forgotten by his Father? Pastor Hollis just told us that during the crucifixion, during this dark moment, that Jesus did not have his faith shaken, but he stood strong, and I knew that must be true. We see Jesus dealing with all these emotions ahead of time in Gethsemane, where he's going and praying and asking the Father, if there's another way, let this cup be taken from me. And he battles through all those emotions, and he comes out on the other side strong. And when Judas shows up, Jesus says to him, what you've come to do, do quickly, which I take that as meaning, bring it on, that Jesus is ready. He's prepared. And yet, one of the last words of Christ is, my God, why have you forsaken me? Let me read the context of that, Matthew 27. Read a section of scripture, events before and just after. Matthew 27, 41 through 50. In the same way, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders mocked him. He saved others, they said, but he can't save himself. He's the king of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now if he wants him. For he said, I am the Son of God. In the same way, the robbers who were crucified with him also heaped insults on him. From the sixth hour until the ninth hour, darkness came over all the land. About the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of those standing there heard this, they said, he's calling Elijah. Immediately, one of them ran and got a sponge. He filled it with wine vinegar, put it on a stick, and offered it to Jesus to drink. The rest said, now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to save him. And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. So we see here Jesus says, it translated, my God, why have you forsaken me? Was Jesus feeling forsaken, in despair? What was going on here? It doesn't make sense that Jesus would have lost his faith and felt rejected by the Father. What's happening? Well, we see in this statement, Jesus is not declaring himself to be a victim that was forsaken by his Father, but he is referencing Psalm 22. This is the first verse in Psalm 22. My God, why have you forsaken me? Jesus is calling up Psalm 22 that those who are there would recognize that what is happening is part of God's plan from the beginning. Psalm 22 is an incredible, wonderful, prophetic psalm. I believe there are five prophetic references in Psalm 22. Two of the last words of Christ, one statement from the crowd, and two events that happened to the Lord Jesus Christ. So let me take some selections from Psalm 22. It's 31 verses, so we'll look at a few selections. First, the prophetic part, the part that is looking forward. This is a Psalm of David looking forward to the crucifixion of Christ. Again, verse 1, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from the words of my groaning? Then verses 7 and 8, All who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. He trusts in the Lord. Let the Lord rescue him. We read in Matthew the same thing. He trusts in God, verse 43. Let God rescue him now if he wants him. We see Jesus saying, my God, why have you forsaken me? In verse 1, of course, written by King David hundreds of years before Christ. And then verse 8 of Psalm 22, he trusts in the Lord. Let the Lord rescue him. Continues on, jumping down to verse 16. Dogs have surrounded me. A band of evil men has encircled me. They have pierced my hands and my feet. Of course, we know Jesus on the cross had his hands and his feet pierced. I can count all my bones. People stare and gloat over me. Verse 18, they divide my garments among them and cast lots for my clothing. We see two situations that happened to Jesus. His hands and feet were pierced, and they cast lots for his clothing. This is Jesus calling this, calling up this prophecy, this psalm, this prophetic psalm, and letting the crowd know that he is part of God's plan. This whole thing is not the anger of a crowd. This is the plan of God. The very last words of Psalm 22 is, for he has done it. King James, that he hath done this. That reminds me of it is finished. So Psalm 22 starts with, my God, why have you forsaken me? And it finishes with, that he hath done this. He has done it. That happened right at the end of the section in Matthew 27 that we read. When Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. When we look at the Gospel of John, John 19:30, we see that when Jesus gives up his spirit, he says, it is finished. So Psalm 22, the first half of it, talks about the suffering of Christ, the pain that he's in, the hardships that he goes through. It ends with, it is finished. There's a turn. In verses 19 through 21, Jesus references Psalm 22. I think most of the people there would have been familiar with Psalm 22, the religious people, the Jewish people. But you, O Lord, be not far off, O my strength. Come quickly to help me. Deliver my life from the sword, my precious life from the power of the dogs. Rescue me from the mouth of the lions. Save me from the horns of the wild oxen. As far as I know, this is why people would think that he was calling Elijah. He was calling for help, is because they understood the turn from the first half of the psalm, which is about the suffering and the lamentation over it. Then there's the calling out to God. And I've done a little bit of research. I'm not satisfied with what people say about how people thought he was calling Elijah, or if he wasn't, or whatever. But I see that as people understanding that Jesus was making his appeal. Then the rest of the psalm, after the turn, we see the final results, the victory gained that Christ grabbed hold of. Verse 23, you who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, honor him. Revere him, all you descendants of Israel. For he has not despised or disdained the suffering of the afflicted one. He has not hidden his face from him, but has listened to his cry for help. So that says that Jesus was not forsaken. If this is prophetic about what's going on, Jesus is not forsaken. Verse 27, all the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord. All the families of the nations will bow down before him. This is talking about that the gospel will go throughout the whole earth. Verse 29, all who go down to the dust will kneel before him. Those who cannot keep themselves alive, every knee will bow before the Lord. Posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord. They will proclaim his righteousness to a people yet unborn. Future generations will believe. That's the church age. Jesus is our Messiah. He is our champion. He is our conquering hero. He was no victim, and he was not forsaken except for a moment. He was forsaken for a moment for you and me. I'm going to invite the worship team up. We're going to We're going to sing In Christ Alone in just a moment. Jesus, again, our Messiah, our champion, the conquering hero, but for a moment he received the punishment for all of us. But now he has the eternal victory. Trust in what Jesus has done. Trust in the fact that he loved you so much that he was willing to go through this for you. And if you are suffering, if you are in that moment of great pain, believe to get through to the other side. This is Good Friday. We honor the Lord for the crucifixion and what he did. But it's not the end of the story. And this is not the end of the story for you. If you're suffering, don't lose your faith. Don't feel forsaken, but realize we serve a God that never leaves us or forsakes us. So trust him in your hardship.
We have heard about the forgiveness of God, forsaken of God, and today the thirst of God. We're going to conclude with John chapter 19, verse 28 to 30. It says this, later, knowing that everything had now been fulfilled, so the scripture would be fulfilled, that everything had been finished, so that the scripture would be fulfilled. Jesus said, I am thirsty. A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of hyssop plant, and lifted it up to Jesus' lips. With that, he received the drink, and Jesus said, it is finished. And with that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Did you know that 72% of the world, of the earth, is comprised of water? Water is literally everywhere. In my imagination, I wonder if Jesus, from the vantage point of the cross, up on top of the cross, on top of Calvary's Hill, would be able to look out and see streams and lakes, or perhaps even cisterns and wells. And yet, from the cross, Jesus says, I thirst. The human body is comprised of somewhere around 65% water. Water is required for the body to sufficiently maintain physical control or muscle control, mental control, even consciousness is dependent upon sufficient water. And when the human body becomes dehydrated, there's an automatic outcry. There's a clawing for water, a desperation for relief, a yearning where one says, I'm thirsty. And Jesus, the creator of the universe, when he had finished everything, just as he was about to drive the final nail into the death of the devil, to pay the final price for all of sins, to finish the race that he was born to run, there on the threshold of human history, at the finish line, as if his body was crying out, I thirst. Jesus the Messiah was born of a virgin and lived 33 years in a hard scrabble world life. Never once had he sinned. Never once had he lied. Never once had he cheated. Never once had he stole a thing. And the irony of it all, after a life so well lived, would be dying of something as simple as thirst. Think about this. Even making water is second nature to Jesus. I mean, of all the water that exists on the whole planet, he created it in the beginning. And then on one day, he simply separated all the water from the earth and water from the sky and the clouds. The next day, he created all the lakes, the streams, and the oceans in a day. Jesus split one of those seas one day just so the children of Israel could walk across on dry ground. 6 million Jews in the desert clawing out for thirst, and Jesus simply had Moses slap a rock, and enough water came out of that rock to satisfy millions. God once caused it to rain so hard, so long, it flooded not just an area, but the whole world, and floated an ark with all of the animals of the world inside of it. Elijah the prophet once prayed a simple prayer, and after a 3-year drought, a deluge came down. Jesus walked on water. Jesus commanded, the wind and the waves, and the wind and the waves themselves obeyed. Jesus turned water into wine. He was the master of water. And yet, on the cusp of human history, with all of humanity utterly dependent on this one final act of death, he says, I thirst. I just want to make a couple of very simple points about the thirst of the Messiah. And the first is that Jesus' thirst was the thirst of a man's dying body. Modern, sophisticated Minnesotans, as we are, we understand the importance of proper hydration. We drink 8 glasses of water a day. We live among 10,000 lakes. Many of you watching this service right now have at your right or hand at your left a bottle of water. I mean, we walk around with them everywhere we go. Take a look at it. It's right there. You've got water. Jesus was dying. His body was dying from a lack of oxygen in his lungs upon the cross. Blood that had now drained from his veins and here a lack of water in his body. This great warrior, this great king, just moments from this victory is dying of thirst. The Gospels tell us that this moment in Jesus' life was at the end of the longest of days, for just his last meal was perhaps 20, 24 hours prior to that. And then after this meal, he took a hike to a garden where he prayed for at least a solid hour, bleeding blood in anxiety and anxiousness. At the end of that, he was betrayed by a friend. He was then arrested and manhandled by Jewish thugs, taken into custody and interrogated all night long, to be ended with being laughed at and mocked, and then marched across town to a palace at daybreak. There he was beaten. He was whipped within an inch of his life and then forced to walk perhaps a half a mile to Golgotha, bearing at least part of the way his own heavy cross, and not once is there any indication of any mercy that anyone would have seen this man and given him a drink of water. Jesus was then nailed to a cross and hung up in the sun to die. For 3 hours he suffered in the heat of the day, and at midday noon the skies turned dark, and he hung for 3 more hours as God seemed to shut heaven itself up in grief. So it's no wonder that after a night of pain and betrayal and abuse, after 6 hours of execution, that Jesus' body cries out for water. I thirst. So Jesus' body thirsted, but secondly, his body was dying. The thirst of Jesus was the thirst of a parched soul. Let me explain, because there is a thirst which is greater than the thirst of a body. It is a thirst of the soul that causes an anguish greater even than crucifixion. John chapter 4, Jesus encounters a woman whom he tells that he has a gift to give to her, which is a drink, a water, which he claims to be living water. And he says these words in verse 14, "Whoever drinks of the water I will give to him shall never thirst. But the water I give to him will become within him a well of water springing up to eternal life." Not water that comes from a well over there, but water which comes from a well inside of here. See, the thirst of the soul is a thirst that causes all of the crime and all of the selfishness, all of the divorce, all of the illness, all of the death. It is a thirst of the soul which parched people will go to a frenzy to try to alleviate. They will seek some sort of relief and excitement, or in athletics, or in amusement, or popularity, or achievement, or riches, or sexuality. But the only real relief for the thirst of the soul is for the existence of the presence of God. The psalmist in Psalm 42 relates this well. He says, "As the deer pants for the water brook, so my soul pants for thee, O God. When will I come before thee?" Jesus once told a story of a rich man who had died and was sitting in hell. These are the words that this dying man in hell, this dead man in hell, said in Luke chapter 19. It says, "In Hades he lifted up his eyes, and being in torment, he cried out and said, 'Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus so that he might dip the tip of his finger in water and cool off my tongue, for I am in agony in this flame.' And Jesus replied to him, 'You had your chance while you lived. And besides, between you and me, there is an inseparable gulf.'" You see, the rich man's thirst was not for water, but his agony and thirst was of his soul for the presence of God. The worship team's going to come and sing one last song, but I want to share with you briefly that Jesus' thirst, he experienced this thirst of the soul, this parchment of the soul, the abandonment of God himself, so that you would not have to experience one day longer a thirst in your soul. Jesus gave his life once, so that you and I could live forever, so that the well of water would be inside of you, springing up to eternal life. You have a chance right here and right now where you live. So as they sing this song, my question to you, will you surrender your life to the only one who can answer the deepest question and thirst of your soul? There's an old song we sing that says, "As sinners plunged beneath this flood lose all their guilty stains." Would you today?
Well, thank you so much for tuning into our Good Friday service. We want to thank Good Hope and Pastor Mike and the rest of the Good Hope team that joined us this evening. We hope we are so blessed that we as the body of Christ can join together and to remember Good Friday. But would you bow your heads with me and pray with me as we close out this service? Jesus, we thank you. Jesus, we are in awe of you for what you did for us. That you, an innocent man, fully God, fully man, went to the cross for us, paid the price that was meant for us, yet you took it upon yourself. Thank you for your sacrifice, God. Thank you, Lord. All that pain, all that agony that you endured, you did it for the sake of wanting relationship with us, God. We cannot thank you enough. You saved our lives. You have literally saved our lives, God. Thank you. Thank you. I pray, Lord, for anyone's listening, feeling discouraged, feeling forsaken, thank you, God, that you never leave us, you never forsake us. That you are always present. You are always near. Pray for anyone searching for salvation. Lord, may they find it in you, Jesus. And then if anyone's discouraged, anyone's feeling hopeless, thank you, Lord, that Sunday's coming. Resurrection's coming. So, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for this time to be together, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for what you did on the cross, God. And may we never forget. We love you, Lord. We bless you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, once again, thank you for tuning in. Have a great rest of your day, great rest of your weekend. God bless.